All right, good morning, everybody. Welcome. Everybody get enough bagels, coffee, and stuff? If not, grab some. Bob is not here today, unfortunately. He is sick, but we are glad that he did not bring that down here to us. Sorry, Bob. But hopefully he gets better soon. He's got, we had to cancel the 100K Club launches that are tonight and tomorrow and move them out 2 weeks. Should be clear, he should be good by then. So he's got them moved. Hopefully you all, anybody that registered, hopefully you got a direct email about that. Plus anybody that got the email for this meeting, if you did not sign up for the 100K, hopefully you got that as well and read that part of it to see when the dates and times are for the launches. So do not show up tonight. Do not show up tomorrow morning. Nobody's going to be there. And there was a change too on the day one. It moved back to pro, which is where we had the last session one. So just make note of that, that it's not at the hotel there on Almerton. It's at back at Pro for the daytime one. The night one's still here in Oldsmar, same location, just a different date. So check that out. What else? It's a little early, but dues are next month for the fourth quarter dues. So just have that in mind if you need to change any information with Maureen about your banking or whatever for the monthly dues or the quarterly dues for Future Home Realty. So just note that. I have not seen any big changes. Anybody go to the FAR convention? We had a few people there. It was a good time. They had a great expo, a lot of interesting products there, and then a lot of great classes. So if you guys have never gone to that, you may want to check out the next time it comes around. It's every summer and over in Orlando, it's perfect. Great little getaway, but they have a ton of great classes, especially the educational ones. I mean, I get a lot out of those. They have committees and things like that, but they have all these educational trainings that go on, and whether it be Form Simplicity or, I don't know, just MLS stuff, legal updates, things like that are really nice. And then you can actually sit in on some of these open committee meetings and just watch and see how the process works. If you ever want to get involved and become a, you know, a director or something like that at Florida Realtors, you can, you know, obviously apply for that. But then you can get involved in these committees and stuff. And it's, yes, it's volunteer, but it's, I mean, it's getting involved in the real estate community. So it's pretty good to do that if you're ever interested. What else do we have? We have elections coming up for GTAR members. I know Tom's running. Are you running too?
No.
Oh, no. Okay. Okay. Yeah. So maybe take a look at those and, you know, whatever, just campaigning for them as far as, and we totally support Tom and all the, you know, for him as a director there. So, and then their list there that they're handing around, if you see that. Is that the same one, Tom?
So I can explain to you. This is a group of past presidents from GTAR that put this out, which is the slate that they're proposing. Some of these are from the nominating committee. I actually was selected by the nominating committee, and some are not, but they're recommending for the things, the changes that are going to be happening at GTAR, that this would be the slate to vote for. So,
yeah, and we can get that out to everybody to take a look at. That is GTAR members. I'll probably just send it to the GTAR group. If you don't get it, let me know, but it'll probably just be that group, because obviously if you're not with them, you can't vote for it. So what else? Is there a tech user group coming up?
There is no tech user group tonight because the trade, the expo is going to be held on the 23rd. Which is an all-day affair. We've posted a couple of things into the 100K Club. There's a schedule there. You can go to the GTAR website. You don't have to be a member of GTAR to come to that. I would suggest it highly that you register if you want the free lunch. If you don't register, you won't get a ticket for lunch.
Okay, cool. All right, what else do we have? Sponsors. Let's go around. I guess we'll just go because you're with them. So I'll just go to you guys. Wait, let me do this. So otherwise, we're off camera. And, sorry, guys. That's better. One man show here. All right. Who wants to talk? You want to go? You want to go? You all?
Can you just hold it?
Yeah, just hold that.
Good morning. I'm Tanya Morningstar with American Patriot Title with David Rankin, the attorney and owner of American Patriot Title and the attorney for GTAR. I apologize for walking in a couple minutes late, but I wouldn't change it for the world. The clicking of my heels sparked a story from one of the young ladies that live here, and she had to stop me and tell me the story, how she met her husband. I'm sorry, I'm like all emotional right now, but it was like the sweetest story. So let me breathe here. So I've met a lot of you coming to these meetings for over a year now, David and I, and we often share how David is the attorney for GTAR and how he's represented over hundreds of real estate agents in front of FREC, which we hope you never visit. He does a lot of work with Bob. We've done a lot of work with you guys, but there's a lot of behind the scenes things that we do. I'm sorry, I'm still out of breath. There's a lot of behind the scenes things that we do too that you guys don't see or maybe even hear about. There's many times I've sat down with agents and worked on their business plan with them. We've worked with brokers to give them marketing advice for their company and so on and so on. So we're really a partnership when you decide to give American Patriot Title a chance and work with us. Another thing that I wanted to point out, and I'm sure a lot of you are familiar, are the backpacks that GTAR collects. This is an organization near and dear to my heart. GTAR, one of the many things they do, is they collect backpacks for kids. And these backpacks are not necessarily just for school. They're for children in the foster care system. And a lot of times when kids move from home to home, they're doing it with a garbage bag or whatever they have. So if you come across, now that school is already in session, I'm sure there's lots of clearance items, and you want to donate a backpack, you can drop it off with American Patriot Title. We're next to right south of Cheval on North Del Mabry. I'll be happy to come get it from you. You can leave it at your office at Future Home, or you can drop it off at GTAR, and they have many other locations. But just keep this in mind to give back to the community. Thank you. Tanya Morningstar, American Patriot Title.
Do I really need to use this? It's helpful for the homes at home.
Okay. Good morning, Bob, and good morning, Future Home Realty. For any of you that don't know me, I'm Jerry Papa, owner of Gulfview Realty Property Management. And hopefully many of you have come to know me as your trusted partner, both in lease and property management services throughout Tampa Bay. And as many of you know, we pay referral fees. We use a 21st century cloud software-based system. We integrate with our owners and with our tenants by way of the cloud with password-protected portals. And we service all the Tampa Bay area with professional lease and property management services. I am on the Property Management Council at PRO, and we help to instruct and educate people with regards to property management and how to properly adhere to all the guidelines as well as rules and regulations in this state. And as many of you know, we have plenty of rules and regulations. With that said, we have been contemplating other opportunities out there. And recently I came in contact with a gentleman who has been in the real estate business and has been a real estate broker for about 20 years, a very trusted individual who has a sterling record in the business and is also a very good friend of a friend of mine that's on the Property Management Council. And I passed out to each of you today something for you to look at and consider as it relates to further investing and looking at other opportunities that yield a much better rate than putting your money in CDs or even in property management for that matter. If you have any questions about the program and how we will manage the program and or how Phil will actually be very directly engaged in this program, please see me after the meeting and or send me an email or reach out to me by way of phone or text. Thank you very much.
All right. Okay, cool. All right, we had to do a little bit of scrambling, and luckily our awesome partners, not partners in monetary sense, but partners in the real estate world, Kevin and Brian, have put together a program for you. They're going to go over some stuff. I don't even know what it is, so it's going to be an awesome surprise. But I'm going to turn it over to them, so I'm going to enjoy it with you guys. Here you go.
I thought you had it prepared.
No.
Well, this is going to be awkward. No, I'm kidding. Yeah, let's go up here. So I was expecting turnout to be about three times as much since Bob's not here, but this is what it is. So I want to talk about a couple things real quick that are unrelated, some upcoming dates that you should have a pad and a paper. That's the same thing, a pad and a pen in front of you. We just did a meeting a couple weeks ago. Some of you were there, and most of you were not, and it was a huge success. It was a breakfast meeting. It was about a three-hour meeting that took about 4 hours, and we had around 60 agents show up, and it was very good. It was my underwriter, Victoria, from Stewart Title, talking about the TRID, which is something we're going to discuss a little bit today. She was going into the nuts and bolts of how it works. We're going to talk more about real life situations that it may create and how to turn those into opportunities. So because that was such a success, we asked all of the agents there to tell us if they want to do another one. And surprisingly, for free food and free education, they were on board. And also what topics they would like discussed. So if you could write down the date of Thursday, December 3rd, I think this is going to be a quarterly thing. The first one was called Become a Better Agent. So we're very creative in the title industry. So we're going to be, this is going to be called Become a Better Agent Part 2. And the topic that I discuss at these is primarily how to control title when you have the buyer's side of the transaction. We touched on that for about a half hour at the first meeting. I'm going to go into greater detail as far as the legal side of why you should do that and how it really is beneficial for your buyer. I'm not sure what the other topic will be, but we're going to limit it to just two speakers. I'll let everyone know what that will be. We're looking at a couple different people now to sponsor it and do that for us. So other dates, Saturday, October 10th at the Highland Park, or is the Highland Park Music Festival. Highland Park's a area, it's a subdivision, a development right here up in West Chase, right across the street from Water Chase. They recently put in some very, very nice apartments, which should mean future buyers to all of you. And they have a music festival. It's a very casual, very cool all-day thing on a Saturday. And they're looking for more vendors to sponsor it. My company is going to be one of those sponsors. The cost for sponsorship is a whopping $50. And they'll probably have about 600 residents there, all of whom are eventually going to sell a house or buy a house. So if you're looking to get some exposure without spending much money and have a good time, I would check that out. Just email me if you want the registration form for that. What else? So this is a little ways off, but please plan for our annual golf tournament, which is going to be Friday, February 5th. And unlike most tournaments, we're going to have a lot of stuff leading up to it. The tournament itself will be just like last year, where it is a benefit for Hope Children's Home. We raised about $3,500 for them last year, which was fantastic. And a lot of that, most of that came from the players. But instead of just having a golf tournament, as the host of the tournament, I get to say hi to everybody for 2 minutes and that's it, because it's just crammed into one day. So we're also going to have the Friday before, which is January 29th. We're going to have a practice round. Also, both of these are at the Eagles. Eagles Golf Course. I live there. It's a great place, and they give me a great deal for the tournament. So any players who are playing in the tournament can come and play a full 18-hole practice round on the same course the Friday before. And for all of you who are saying, I don't know how the hell to play golf, that's okay, because every single Thursday, and this has been going on for 2 months, and it's going to go on until the event, every Thursday at 2:30 p.m. at the Eagles driving range, unless it's raining, which recently has been every Thursday at 2:30 p.m., we have free instruction. So come there, bring clubs if you have them. If you don't, you can rent them. I'm paying for all of this. We have a golf pro. They have three pros there, and one or more of them will be there every time to give an hour-long free lesson to whoever's there as a guest of ours. And typically, when it's not raining, that driving range turns into 9 holes of golf. So take advantage of that. Even if you're not going to play in the tournament, come get some free lessons. It's a beautiful place and it's fun. Yeah. So this is Bobby Callahan. He's my director of business development. He's doing a great job. He's a long time in the mortgage business and has been with me for a few months. He's a marketing guy with a marketing background. If you need help with marketing, you need to bounce ideas off of either of us, Bobby's typically more available than me, although I try, but get in touch with him for that. What he just passed around that you don't know what it is, goes on the back of your phone, and when you go into the gym, instead of taking your wallet, stick a debit card in there, you go into a meeting, throw three or four business cards in there, and if you push it in the middle correctly, pops up and it stands up your phone. Your kids are going to want it for watching TV and shows and YouTube on their phones. So there you go. We had a bunch of those left over from the mortgage show. And then for anyone who, we like to do fun stuff with our clients and with our friends. I mean, title insurance and closing is not the most exciting thing. Once in a while, we get a really creative transaction that we have to work through, and I love that. I'm working on one right now. But every Friday at 9 a.m., if you've been to the Silver Dollar Shooters Club, which is in Odessa over on Patterson Road, very cool place. A couple of my clients and I meet there every Friday at 9. We have breakfast. They have a little cafe. And then we go out to the, they have trap, skeet, five stand, crazy quail. If you don't know what those things are, that's cool. Come there. You can try to outshoot us, which you may do. You can have never shot a shotgun before, but you want to learn. Just come join us. 9 o'clock every Friday morning at Silver Dollar. And that's, again, on us. So don't complain why our fees are too high, because we do all this stuff for you guys and it costs money. So that's all I have for that. What Bobby passed around, or any questions about any of that stuff? No? Okay. So this is my partner for the day, Brian, and I thought it would be best if we had a more of a discussion than a presentation. What you have in front of you is something you've probably seen, you may not have seen. It's called the closing disclosure, and we're not going to go through it in great detail. It is, it's called the TRID, which TRID stands, there's no more HUD beginning October 3rd, and TRID is the new thing, and that stands for the Tealer RESPA Integrated Disclosure. This is the CFPB's idea of how to help the consumer, and it's at heart, their heart's in the right place, but logistically it's going to be pretty challenging. The the biggest issue with this is, well, there's a few. So you haven't seen this before, you're working with a buyer, and let's picture a typical scenario. First time home buyer, let's say they're working with a mortgage broker and their lender is Flagstar. So Flagstar is going to be required for any buyer who, borrower, so it's on a, same thing on a refi, but for you it's a buyer. Any buyer who applies for their mortgage after October 2nd, so on October 3rd, which I think is a Saturday, so that might not be exactly that, but that's when this goes into place. And Brian can correct me if I say something wrong, because he knows what I'm talking about better than I do. They, when the time comes for closing, this form, a final form, which is the closing disclosure is what most people are calling it, must be delivered to that buyer 3 days prior to closing. And so here are the things that are going to happen. One, the lenders wisely are taking on, it seems that they're all taking on the role of delivering it to the client, because they're ultimately responsible for it. Technically speaking, they could get it to the title company or the mortgage broker and we could get it to them, but then they wouldn't necessarily be able to prove that it got there in the right time to be compliant. So let's go back to this scenario. You've got a young lady at home in her apartment. She's a first-time home buyer trying to buy a home. She's got a mortgage broker, a title company, a buyer's agent, and a lender. And Flagstar, the lender, 3 days prior to, typically is going to email this closing disclosure, which again are final numbers, to your client, probably without much explanation. And the person who sent it to your client is probably responsible for sending a couple hundred out per day. So certainly not looking intimately at the loan and figuring anything out. So then if you look at, and again, we're not going to go through the whole thing, but just looked at the last page. So the bottom half of the last page is going to show them who the parties involved in the transaction are and their contact information. So this has a lender and all of their info, the buyer's agent, the seller's agent, and the settlement agent or title company. They they give this information and that's great. And if you look at the halfway down at the left there, it says questions. If you have questions about the loan terms or costs on this form, use the contact information below. And then here's the really good part. To get more information or make a complaint, contact the CFPB at this website. Here's from a real world, there's going to be a huge learning curve, just like when the HBCC first came into being something real. Eventually, the lenders and everyone got it figured out, and it became smoother again. After a few months, and Brian can attest to this, after a few months, the lenders, they'll have their stuff together, and they'll be delivering this on time. So let's forget about the issues that happened in October and think about January when it's getting done, streamlined, on time. The biggest problem I see is you're the buyer's agent, Brian's their originator, I'm their title company, and guess who hasn't seen this, and guess who doesn't get this? The buyer's agent, the loan originator, and the title company. Because that person at Flagstar is not required to send it to anyone other than the consumer. So they're not going to. There may be exceptions to that, but there typically won't. So this is already a little challenging to read just because it's a new form. If you're looking at it now, you can figure it out, but it's not that simple. It's because you've been looking at HUDs forever, or at least the top of page two. So they're going to call you if they have a good relationship with you, and you're not going to know what to tell them. They're going to call Brian, and he doesn't have this form. They may call me, but I think their next call or their next action may be to make a complaint. So, and in some cases, it might be their first action. They may say, well, this isn't, these, what the heck? My interest rate is 4.174. It's supposed to be 3.875. Well, that's their APR. They don't necessarily know the difference. So they call right there to make a complaint. And of course, the APR is right above the info on where to make a complaint. So the points are that particularly in the beginning, when this starts happening, you've got to be ultra involved with your buyers. They have to know to expect this. And I think if you're really doing your job right, it is, hey, Miss Buyer, you're going to get an email from Flagstar. Don't open it. Forward it to me. Let's get on the phone. Let's open it together and go through it. There's nothing saying they can't release this to you. From the title company side, I see a problem with everything is very last minute now. We certainly have buyers waiting at closing tables for the package to be delivered to us by the lender because things just get bogged down, especially at month end. And that's going to be eliminated by this. It has to be. But what I don't like about it the most is now a lot of times the first time the consumer sees the HUD is at the closing table, but they're sitting down with the closer who's closed thousands of these transactions. You put them across the table from me, I'm going to explain everything perfectly. So would Tanya and so would David. We know what we're doing. This is what we do for a living. They don't. So I see a lot of confusion happening there. I really recommend, I know a lot of, when I do a closing, I always ask everyone, I ask the buyer, why did you choose this realtor? Unless the realtor's in the room. And why did you choose this lender, or how did you choose them? And then I asked the seller the same thing. Why did you use this realtor? And it's really good information for me because then I can help my clients learn this is what seems to work, this is what doesn't. And it's amazing how many buyers choose their lender because they got a flyer, or because they saw a commercial, or because they bank at that bank, or something like that. And I think that a lot of buyer's agents say, okay, cool, lending is covered. There you go. If something goes wrong, you chose them. And that's a common mindset. But I believe that your smartest thing to do is best case, we can't steer, but best case suggest that they use someone that you already know, that you have a relationship with, that you know you can call, excuse me, the originator and say, what's going on with this? How do I do this? What, you know, anything. If you're calling the lady at Flagstar, nothing against Flagstar, but you're going to communicate with her probably for the first time ever, and maybe for the last time. And second best case, if they say, no, I'm using so-and-so bank, fine. Find out who it is, develop a rapport early, with that originator and make sure that the three of you are working as a team. And really the four of you, you should be involved with the title company as well, which gets back to not letting the seller tell you where to go with your client. But that's for another day. And then timing with contract close, contract periods. If you want to close in 30 days, no. It's a bad idea, and you're giving a bad service to your buyer to tell them, unlike other agents, I'm going to ram this through in 30 days. Don't. And I'm going to pass it to Brian because I'm a little long-winded here. But the best advice, Bobby and I were on the radio a couple weeks ago, and I was talking about the CFPB stuff, and it was the Jamie Maloney show, and Jamie said, so what advice do you have for consumers? I said, apply before October 2nd. Long pause, long awkward pause. That's it. That's the best advice. So if you think about right now, here we are in early September, every single person that you're working with or that you want to work with as a buyer, don't email them, don't mail them, call them. Call them and say, look, I'm learning about all this CFPB stuff. It's going to be great eventually, but I'm sure the last quarter of this year, it's going to be a mess. So if you want to get a mortgage, now is the time to apply. Call Brian or call whoever your go-to person is and get that application in before that time. And then once October 3rd gets here, just be really patient and expect delays, expect problems, and expect it to get better. Cool? Questions, concerns, problems? So now this guy actually knows what he's talking about. So here's Brian.
Just got one question.
Yes.
Cash buyers doesn't involve anything involved.
This doesn't involve cash buyers. Shockingly, it doesn't have anything to do with reverse mortgages. They're exempt from this. I find that amazing. Reverses are, we do a ton of them. We have a Chicago-based client that sends a lot of reverse mortgages to us, like three or four a day in Florida and California. And you would think they would be the most protected borrower. Because of their age and their sometimes lack of kind of sophistication and understanding things, they seem to be the least. The fees that are charged are enormous, and consumer protection type things that go into place just never apply to them. And they're all FHA mortgages. So not sure why. Yes, sir?
Yeah, and I've been to the program.
I'm surprised you're not teaching them by now.
Video on the 100K plan that that actually goes through this and you can play it over and over again if you're unsure of certain pieces. But in all the classes that I've been to, not one word has been spoken to who's going to handle the estimate of closing costs and so forth for the seller. This is all about the buyer. There's nothing here about the seller. Plus the fact that the title company is still going to be responsible for doing the distribution of funds, okay, which is going to be similar to a HUD that we see now. I don't know what you guys are going to come up with.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's responsibilities here on if you're a listing agent that you need to know about this as well. As a buyer's agent, because you need to inform your sellers how long it's going to take to get these loans closed.
Right.
And the seller is never going to see this form.
There is a.
This is strictly for the buyer.
There is a seller's closing disclosure that's been developed. I didn't bring that because I didn't want to bring too much stuff, but it's not required to be given to anyone. Yeah. So it's more like a like.
The situation I'm trying to explain here is that. There, as agents, we need to know what both sides are going to be doing, not just what one side is going to be doing.
Correct.
Every class I've been to, every webinar I've done online, every video I've seen, only talks about this one.
Because this is the one that the CFPB requires. So yeah, but. Right. So there is the seller's disclosure. I look at that similar to a preliminary HUD, where I know that my company, and I'm sure American Patriot does too, we send a preliminary HUD with every title commitment that we send, and that'll be replaced by that seller's disclosure.
But that's going to be a good form as well, and none of us have ever is going to be uniform across all companies, is a specific title company.
Got your next class.
And so forth. Those are issues that we need to know about.
Okay. Stop by, because I have those forms. I just didn't bring them. And getting back to the form at closing, ALTA, the American Land Title Association, I don't know if it's nationwide. I know that's nationwide, but I'm not sure if they've adopted it everywhere. But the underwriters, at least the ones that I know of in Florida, have all adopted it. It's a new closing form that's going to replace the HUD. So this isn't – they signed this acknowledging receipt of it so that the lender can be in compliance, but they're not obligated to anything at that point, which a lot of people are going to have a problem with signing. But the closing statement is it's a simplified HUD. It's a spreadsheet. And to be honest, my closers and I are doing a 10-hour class tomorrow to get trained on that, because it is a new thing. And I think ALTA just and David might know this better, but I think ALTA just decided to implement that. So it should be statewide. It should be on all closings. Yes.
What's going to be happening
yes.
October 3rd, as it is this form.
Yes. If something affects buyers, it affects your sellers. There's no question. So that's great points. Yeah. The one we did a couple weeks ago was kind of that. But I'll tell you what I'll do. After tomorrow, I think I'm going to be an expert, at least compared to how I am now, and I'll put together a time in September prior to this launching, and I'll get it out to everyone and say this is when we're going to do it, where we're going to do it. Maybe we do it here. I'm not sure. I'll figure something out, because that should happen. And if you don't get an email from me, check Insured Title Agency's Facebook page, because it'll be posted there, and we'll scramble and find a place to do it. Hey. Y'all have a mortgage lender? No? Nobody? Nobody has a mortgage lender? Everyone does? I would just do this. I would just call your mortgage lender like today, this week, and just ask very simply, hey, how are y'all set up for trade? And shut up. Let them talk. That's it. So has anybody not gone over this? Like, is anybody, this is their first time looking at it? First time looking at it? Cool. So would it help if we just like really, really make it simple? Or no? Should we skip over that? No? Hello? 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 Chirp, chirp, chirp. Is that cool? So I know Tom's gone over this a bunch. Anybody else taking a lot of classes on it? No? Anybody that's like the first time really looking at this thing? Cool. So here's the great thing. On one hand, like if y'all heard about this, right? That it's a mess. It's going to be scary. It's going to be like the world's coming to an end, right? So that's very potential. Like I just think there's three main things that as real estate agents, you got to like just kind of be informed of. And my big thing is not, and this isn't the message that Kevin and I kind of talked about either. Isn't like, it's not like a lot of stuff you're hearing. It's like scary. It's just, it is what it is. I mean, I think there's a huge opportunity there. So like if you can go capitalize on the opportunity, then you're going to look super smart in front of your clients. And it's kind of that whole, hey, it's not your fault. It's going to be okay. Here's what we're going to do. And the big thing people are looking for is like, here's what we're going to do. Right? So people that are like, I've never seen this thing. This is crazy. Well, it's five pages. Here's what we're going to do. It's going to make it really, really easy and walk through it. I don't know everything. I don't know every policy. It is going to delay closings. There will be issues. There will be tons of fires that come out of this. It's going to be okay. It's gonna be all right. So, like on the selling side, I think you just like let your people know that there's gonna be some delays, and there's gonna be some people that have a U-Haul packed up and they're ready to go, and they're not gonna be able to move that day because their buyers aren't ready. And you can go like get really aggressive and all that stuff over the lender, but it just might be. I mean, there's gonna be some stuff that's gonna happen that a number was disclosed improperly or a fee wasn't there. I mean, there's gonna be some mistakes that happen, right? Just being real. So I don't want to be the one that like says that, but that's going to happen. Okay. So I would do three things. I would first go find out from the lenders that you're working with how you're prepared for trade. That's the first thing I would do. Okay. The second thing I would do is I would get very, very, very good at how you refer. So just show of hands, who has a lender that they do refer to?
So who does not have a lender that you refer to? Okay, out. And there's like T-Rex all over the place here. T-Rex, hey. So who is that that had a lender that they refer to? Okay. And who was it that does not have a lender that they don't have a lender? Okay. T-Rex, there you go. I would just get really good at it. Because a lot of realtors just aren't very good. So you know what that looks like. Hey, here's what I want you to call. Well, I got my guy, my gal with whatever, you know, big bank, broker, whatever. Or, hey, here's three cards. And that's cool if you know how all three of those lenders roll with their policies. Because it's going to be crazy. You know, when you're asked these questions about trading, you want to find out, like, does Saturday count as a business day for your company or not? So we don't need to get into the details on it, but like that's an important question to ask from the lender. Is Saturday a business day for you or not? Very important. Okay, so and then third thing I would do is you're just going to have to get a little more proactive in how you set up your prequals and how you walk people through the loan process, right? Because the biggest way to combat all this is just to be proactive, right? So like so can someone ask me how we're set up?
How are you guys?
Oh, over at and it's not a self-promotion thing. It's just, man, you just got to get proactive, right? And so the biggest thing is, what would you guys say is the biggest thing that breaks down in the mortgage process? Because, you know, if there's no money, then nothing happens, right? So it's pretty important. So what would you say is like the biggest thing that breaks down that you guys see in buyer side transactions or with your listings? Right, but why?
Our area, when they pre-qualify someone, they just pull an in-file credit report, which does not show everything, and they say, oh, this looks good, and they issue a pre-qualification letter, and then 4 days before closing, when they pull the final credit report, where they pull the entire credit report, there's all these things that come up that say, oh, we didn't know that was there. We didn't know that was there. So you need a lender that's going to pull the full credit report when they give you a pre-qualification letter. That's why I recommend Brian.
And on talking about the buyers affecting your seller,
I think anyone who's been in Florida real estate sales for more than 10 years probably has a guy or girl, seems like it's usually a guy, that he can call and say, hey, I need right now a pre-qualification letter for Joe Blow, and he'll get it done. Is that fraud? I don't know. Is it unethical? Absolutely. But you don't know that a pre-qualified buyer is pre-qualified. Not only, maybe they didn't pull everything, maybe they didn't pull anything. More doom and gloom. Sorry about that.
I'm sorry. So, the doc process, that's what we're talking about, is the pre-qualification process. Hey, Jim, can you hear me okay if I just clip this on?
Great.
So, you guys got to like get involved with that, right? So here's first thing we're gonna do is find out, like, and you could ask this for the next 90 days. If you're on the selling side and you got a prequal or an offer that comes in, you can literally call that lender up and just ask them that simple question. How are you set up for TRID, right? So the second thing we're gonna do is we're gonna get really good at referring, right? Okay, and you might talk to your lender about that you refer to. Hey, how do you want me to refer, right? Because there's different, it's like, so we do these classes over at Pro, and we flash this picture up, and it's a guy that's passed out drunk, fallen over in a stall, clearly at a bar. And it's like, you would not give that guy the keys to drive you home on Saturday night, right? And then another picture pops up, and it's this little kid driving the car. It's like, I would not let that kid drive me home from church on Sunday. So like, why would we give our clients the keys to our calendar for the weekend? It's crazy. It's crazy. So I would get really fanatical. When you get that pre-approval letter that comes in from someone you don't know, I would find that phone number, I would call that lender, and I would ask them things that we're asked all the time. What's the credit score? What's the debt ratio? What kind of job does this guy have? What kind of income are you using? Is it self-employed? Is it not? Have you looked at taxes? Have you pulled the tri-merge? What is this letter? Has it been run through the DU system? Is it approved eligible? What is it? Right? So we developed proactively a program for all this just so that when Tom refers a buyer to me, I can get them, it's offer accepted is the name of the program. I can get them set up so that when Tom goes and makes an offer to Jim as the listing agent, boy, Tom, you give me that phone number of that listing agent, boy, I'm going to call Jim at the time that email comes in. Jim, hey, this is Brian Heckman. You just got a prequal, an offer from Tom, and it was Mr. and Mrs. Johnson. Hey, I just want to let you know, this is exactly what we say. We pre-qualified them, which for us means a tri-merge credit report has been pulled, which is what Tom's referencing, all three bureaus, and this loan has been run through the DU underwriting system. It's got an approved eligible. Fair? Pause. You guys seen with offer multiple offers? A little bit, yeah? You see them a lot. Hey, Tom. Hey, Jim. Hey, man. Are we even in the ballpark on this offer? Let me shut up. And I know what he's going to say. Well, most of them are beating the chat. Ah, I got multiple offers, man. I mean, yeah, come on. Because I know we're competing with it, right? So, great. Hey, Jim. Tom understands the business. This is not my script, but Tom understands what we're doing. It's not just finding a house. It's actually getting the house. Fair? So Tom understands talking to his buyers as part of how he refers. And the buyers have allowed me to share certain aspects of their file. Hey, Jim, I just want you to know, these are salary borrowers. Mr. Johnson's been in his W-2 job for 10 years. He makes a salary. Mrs. Johnson's a school teacher. She's been in her job for 7 years. Salary. Jim, their debt ratios are 38%. Credit scores are X, Y, and Z. And a lot of times these buyers, they get it. So they will give us the authorization to share not how much they make, not their social security numbers, but does it help you as a listing agent if you know the guy's got a 32% debt ratio, both their jobs are salary, and the guy's got a 710 credit score? It's a big difference, right? And then if we can go in and then just reiterate, hey, Jim, so, oh, by the way, we've already collected 1040s, W-2s, pay stubs, and bank statements. That's already been underwritten. What? Is Maureen here? Smith? Awesome. So like you get these people that literally, here's what we've heard, like, I'm just going to take this offer then. It's a full price offer and I don't really have to go much farther because it's good. That's what we wanted, right? So you're setting people up. So here's what that really does for you guys though, is it really minimizes a lot of these delays down the road. Does that make sense? Because a lot of the stuff that comes up is ultimately it wasn't prequalled right, which means then the documentation that pops in is it's the wrong stuff or it's not right. We can't verify some of the stuff that it was a halfway approval up front, right? That makes sense? Yes. Oh, yeah, call them up. Yeah, call that lender up. That's why we developed that thing. Yeah. Yeah. We got asked that, and I was like, can't be asking me that. Oh, okay. I mean, they try. I'm like, I can't share his credit. Are you kidding me? And then I was like, ding. This was back in November. I was like, ding. That'd be a great thing to proactively help people get into contract, right? Because what it ends up doing is it helps, as a buyer side, it helps you, man, I don't know about you guys, but like the time invested in some of these people is crazy, right? I mean, for you guys especially, I mean, you're driving around, it's just crazy, like multiple offers. And then we call it missing in action buyers. They're really hot today, Saturday, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon while you had plans or the football game's on. And then by Monday morning, they've totally disappeared because their offer got laughed at, right? And then you just invested a weekend. I call that wasting a weekend. And now you can't even get a hold of them again, right? So they just gone MIA on you. And you might have spent 3 or 4 months in these people showing them properties and it's multiple offer they get declined, multiple offer they don't make. Multiple, and then they look at Tom and they're like, well, maybe it's Tom. Let me go switch over here and use somebody else. And Tom's the one that did all the legwork for him. You know what I mean? It's crazy. So real quick, would it help if we ran through this in like 3 minutes? Okay. Really simple. Guys, I love this form. I love this thing. Because on the front end, what we're going to do is we're going to have to give this to them as the lender, right? And the problem with all these forms now, like the current GFE is a 3-page document. They changed it in 2010, I think. It was a 1-page simple little spreadsheet looking thing. Now that 1-page simple spreadsheet looking thing, it's called an initial fees worksheet. But that was the old good faith estimate. Now the good faith estimate's 3 pages, kind of reads like a book. It's just ugly, right? Here's what's crazy. Neither one of those forms need to be signed. Current GFE, current IFW, neither one need to be signed. It's crazy. Actually, my compliance person said, if I have them sign, I think it was the GFE, I'm out of compliance and I can get in trouble for it. I'm like, I just want to acknowledge that they have signed. This is crazy. So here's what this does. If you look on those big black sides there on page 1, loan terms. Pretty simple. Loan amount, interest rate, monthly principal and interest payment, done. Easy, right? Projected payments, payment calculation. Now here's what's crazy, because some people still do ARMs, adjustable rates. So it's gonna give you years 1 through 7 and years 8 through 30. Principal and interest never changes. But then you're gonna see a difference of mortgage insurance, estimating that it drops off after year 7, right? Simple, simple stuff. I'm not gonna go line by line. Look at the bottom part, costs at closing. Here's what's awesome about this form. No longer do I have to highlight in red and then draw a big red arrow to somebody to actually show them this is what your total bottom line cash to close is. Because they only care about three things, right? We call it the big three ideals. You refer somebody in and they're already thinking, here's my ideal price point, here's my ideal payment, and here's my ideal cash to close. That's all they care about. That's all they care about. They care about everything. But Tom will refer somebody in, the guy wants to buy a $340,000 house, and I talk to him and he wants a $1,000 payment and he's got $5,000. Dude, how about $120,000? So hey Tom, this guy's talking about this, those three things, but Tom's like, oh man, I ain't gonna, okay, great. That just saved Tom a bunch of time, right? So here's what's cool about this. Right on page one, no one's ever gonna tell us or you, pretty obvious, cash to close, boom, there it is, right? Flip over page two, same thing. They wanna go itemize this stuff. Top line there, loan costs in black. There's everything. And then the only thing that's different is right now, this stuff is just all kind of a hodgepodge, and it's just in alphabetical order. Origination charges, it's in alphabetical order, A to Z. Services borrower did not shop for, A to Z. They did shop for, A to Z, including title charges in section C. And then you see other costs there. So you got your section E, taxes, F, prepaids, G, the escrow account. And then H, anything other, HOAs, home warranties, all that good stuff. I think this thing's awesome, guys. I see it's a huge opportunity. Here's the deal, though. Just grab it, take a look at it, take this thing home, send Kevin an email and say, thanks for printing this out. It's easy. Page three, calculating cash to close. Pretty simple. Then you can see there, it's loan estimate versus final. So you're gonna be able to tell pretty obviously, did we overestimate or underestimate? Hey, there's all sorts of different tolerances and all that stuff. It's really not that much different than current. We can't be over an eighth of a percent, 0.125% over certain things for certain fees, right? So the good thing is we can, originally they were gonna say we couldn't overestimate fees. For example, if I said the fee's gonna be $100 and it was 50 bucks, I'd have to redisclose the dang thing, which means then, and that's where these delays start to happen, then we have to disclose and wait 3 days before we can close. That's where these things come into play. That's the same thing right now. Anybody have one of those issues before? Like now, closing issue, there's an APR, has to get redisclosed, wait 3 days, same stuff, man. And ladies, sorry, kind of being formal sometimes.
Yeah, but the client can waive that 3 days, correct? Because my client that I just
closed on, he waived that 3 days. That's not this. The APR tolerance is, yeah, it is locked down. There's a different waiving of 3 days. That's not on this stuff though. Yeah, APR. So the good thing is CFPB was gonna say whether it's over-disclosed or under-disclosed, you gotta waive it. I'm sorry, you gotta wait. Right now they're saying, hey, if we over-disclose and we come in lower, that's okay, which is good, right? Because I'm getting the borrower a better deal than what I disclosed to him. So, and then you got summary of transaction, you got all their stuff. But I mean, literally, what's page? Yeah, page four is all sorts of other stuff, late payments, partial payments, all that stuff. But I mean, that's cool about it, page one, it's all right there. Does that make sense? It's all right there. So here's what I would do. I would do those three things we talked about. Find out how your lenders are trade ready. I would get really good at referring. And then I would just get really proactive with the process, the documents. Back up your lender. Man, we gotta get those docs. And we don't need those docs over in a week or 7 days. I mean, there's docs over in 24 hours. And it's how we explain it is, it's just the basic documents. 1040s, W-2s, pay stubs. That's how we calculate their income. And then your bank statements, right? Because if we make it like it's this huge ordeal, that's the perception. But it's like if Mr. Johnson is looking to get a mortgage, there's two things that any mortgage company does, right? So we can go and market, and anybody been to any of our marketing stuff? Okay, great. Chirp, 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 great. Okay, but there's two things that we do. We pre-qualify people to get a mortgage and we close their stinking mortgage. That's it. So if Tom refers somebody to me and the people aren't ready, they probably don't want to pull a credit report. And those pals aren't going to get a pre-approval letter with my name on it if I haven't pulled their credit, right? Same thing, they need to give me all their income, their, and I'm not saying give me all their documents before we issue an approval, because you guys want fast approvals, right? But then you also want perfect approvals too, right? So it's like this whole issue a prequal based on what they verbally told me, right? Jackie's going out today to show property. Jackie can't wait for me to pull somebody's 1040s, W-2s, pay stubs just to say they look good. So the word is pre-qualified, right? But then we gotta know as soon as possible, hey, Jackie, look, I know you went out today, we got him pre-qualified, but then he sent his pay stubs or his whatever in, and he doesn't make what he said that he made. And that happens all the time. You guys deal with that, right? Not the only one? Perfect. So that's some of the things. And then what you end up doing is just in the education process of people, here's an awesome script I would use, okay? There's three steps to getting people cleared to close for the mortgage with all mortgage lenders, with all buyers. There's three steps. Step one is the pre-qualification process, okay? Step two, typically, they get into contract, and then there's an urgency, so then they provide the documents, and typically, once they're in contract, we can go disclose to them, right? Then we submit them to underwriting, formal underwriting. Then we go to step three, it comes out of formal underwriting with their approval conditions, and we work on their clear-to-close conditions, right? So if you could get good at those three steps and educating, like Tom's pretty good at, like educating people of the why. The why is, if you can get me your documents, we will take you to step two. On my team we do. I've got a 19-year underwriting veteran, Lynn, she's an underwriter for 19 years. She pre-underwrites stuff on the front end. So I can't pre-underwrite someone if they don't give me their documents, but Tom will understand if, Mr. Buyer, you can get the documents over and you're pre-underwritten, that phone call to the listing agent when we are in a multiple offer situation becomes a lot more powerful when I can let them know that we read the documents, right? And then step three, everyone loves to know that we're working on clear to close conditions. It's kind of the spot we want to be at, right? So if I'm sitting here talking to Jim on the listing side and we've already reviewed those things, you guys know if you're listing property, right? That's a pretty good deal as opposed to some offer that you don't know anything about. That makes sense? So we have a recorded TRID conversation webinar that we did. I think it was last week or the week before. Did you happen to listen to that one? Is that one of the five that you listened to? And it's the same perspective, right? It's not the end of the world. It's here's some little things that you can do to be prepared for it. If you guys want that, my email is team@theheckmangroup.com. We can email you over the recording on that. The PowerPoint's included, so you can pull that stuff out. I would just get really good at your scripting of explaining this to people and the little itty bitty things you can do to be proactive and help avoid the issues that roll out. Make sense? Cool, questions? Yes, ma'am. Depends on the lender, but there's really no reason they shouldn't be able to close a loan in less than 45 days unless they're not getting documents or unless the pre-qualification was a halfway pre-qual and now there's all sorts of stuff. That's why, I mean, y'all are gonna have to get more involved in the mortgage process. I've been saying that for months and months and months. It's just the way it is. It's not like you have to know everything about them. But for me to call Tom, because I got the okay from the borrower, to say, hey Tom, these guys are at a 54.9999% debt ratio. Tom, here's what I estimated for taxes, for insurance, and all that stuff at your price point of 175. Tom and I can have a conversation, and it's in writing on the prequal. It's like, hey, Tom, here's what I use. I use $200 for taxes. Is that realistic? Well, actually, no, Brian, this house is about 250. Whoa, big problem. Because we're right on the edge as an example of that. Now, like, well, we'd want to close a 54.99% debt ratio deal if we could, wouldn't we? Well, heck yeah. But then what happens if the insurance comes back and now the insurance isn't $1,200 a year, it's $1,300 a year. And then the consensus is it's only $100. But we've been like literally within a dollar a month in payment of it flipping from an approval to a decline, right? So it becomes really, really important. Make sense? Anybody else? Great question. Yeah. Oh, totally loaded question. I would just again, just being proactive on stuff, I would just, if you can call the lender and shoot it straight on what you're hearing is the issue, I mean, we're gonna have issues. You know, when somebody throws a curveball at us and whatever, they have a large deposit or, you know, we can be very proactive and we typically are, but if people aren't getting, like, we kind of tattletale on people to you guys if they're not giving us docs because you need to know early on. But it's, that's kind of, it just depends on what it is. That's it.
It's very similar to CGS. 45 days is an appropriate amount of time. It depends if the buyer is getting everything that, that needs to be done. If the property needs a lot of changes or you know, updates or repairs to make it FHA compliant. Similar to when people ask me, well, how long does it take you guys to process a court sale? Well, we have some sellers that are pros and they get everything to us instantly.
And it's lightning fast. Sometimes they close 30 days. And then we have some sellers that are emotionally disconnected or they're staying in the house. They're squatters basically, and they don't really want the process to move forward. They're just trying to avoid foreclosure. Those might take a year. It might take a year to fail. So it's really dependent upon, a lot of it's dependent upon who the buyer is and how cooperative they are.
Team, like football team, TEAM at the Heckman Group.com. Jim, question?
Yeah,
contributions, like seller contributions, realtor contributions? Could. Yeah. Yeah, so like, well, it just depends. I'm saying could, like, it just depends when that's found out, you know? So I think that's one of those, like, oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, that stuff's got to stop. Yep. It's going to happen, yeah. Yeah. And then, you know, like, everyone wants to set up a system that's perfect, but we're dealing with people. That's a great equalizer. So, like, stuff's going to happen. People in real estate, there's going to be delays. Yes, sir. Not necessarily true. You've been to more of these classes than I probably have, though.
Put down on the house that they're going to buy, you will not be able to do a simultaneous closing because proof of funds has to be supplied to the lender and the lender has to redisclose within 3 days of closing.
I got to check on that. I think that's going to be, that could be a question of how, and this is a lot of the interpretation of this stuff between lenders is going to be a big difference. That might be a great question. Is that question right there? I have not heard that from. Yeah, like right now it's a prior to funding condition. Yeah, I'll find out and post that in the 100K Club. I haven't heard that from our back office that would be an issue. So, but I mean, that's another great question, kind of like the Saturday question if they're open on Saturday. So, great questions logistically. Yep, Jim. Yep. It's not pretty. Yeah, so you probably want to have like, I'm just big on checklists, right? Like pilots have checklists for like everything. And then somehow like we're in real estate and we feel like we don't need checklists. It's all, it's not. But I would do like a pre-close, like we have a pre-closing audit that happens and it's just a checklist. And it's, have there been any changes? Because believe it or not, realtors actually give people credit and they don't tell the lender about it. And there's like addendums and the lender never sees it, believe it or not, that stuff happens. And so, so yeah, it's really, really important to do that stuff and let the lender know, whoever the lender is. Anybody else?
Make it last the whole 60 days if we're trying to get it done in 4 minutes. So
that we can close sooner, or are they going to make that 60 days that closing date, and then it would be another 3 days?
I can't speak for other lenders, but like we had a closing on Friday that the package was there like 2.5 weeks early on a 45-day closing. So I can just tell you, it's a hot potato in my office. Man, I don't want that thing in my office. I want the HUD statement at the title company, right? But yeah, unfortunately, a lot of lenders, that's how it's viewed. Even if the loan's cleared early, it just sits in the closing department because it's on a, yeah. And y'all, you figure it out. You figure out the lenders that that's how they roll, and the lenders that it's like a hot potato. Man, I can beat my chest when I get a package over 2.5 weeks early. So my back office knows that's what we want to do.
Would it behoove us to do 45 days and then have the buyer sign an extension for 15 days?
I think all this stuff sounds great in theory. I think there's no reason you can't close a loan in 45 days under this new process. But if you're the buyer's agent and Tom's the listing agent and Tom's got 5 offers and Tom's got a deal where somebody's calling him telling, hey, the docs are already ready to rock, dude. It's all good to go. And then he calls your lender and your lender's like, I can't give you that information. Tom's probably going to be like, well, Mr. Seller, this guy's already this far along in the process. He's saying 40 days. She's saying 60. And that's why it's really important to get this stuff figured out, because you're going to lose contracts because of this. The savvy listing agent that sat through these classes, they're going to know the questions to ask, and they're going to be advising their clients one way. And you're going to come in and be like, well, everybody told me 60 days. And he's going to be like, oh, that's not the case. But then Tom just got to realize, as a listing agent, 45-day transactions, they might not close, because Tom's not going to be able to pick the buyer's lender all the time. So Tom's going to run into issues on the lending, on the selling side, that there's going to be delays, you know? Yes.
The guy makes over $1 million a year, private credit, you know, he's putting 50% down. Okay. The 11th hour, I get a call. We need to see you have a contingency upon satisfactory home inspection and termite. They want to see the report. We also had a well inspection, and during that inspection, they paid it and they came back to do something or a pump or something. And he would not let us close until we gave him a receipt for the pump. He had to call the well guy. But I mean, when does a lender, is this a new program where the lender is now getting involved in micromanaging the realtor? That's our job, to make sure that things have been repaired or replaced. Why is the lender having to go above to actually call the well people? They could call workers. They're in their truck. They don't have the paperwork in front of them. You know what I'm saying? And that actually caused a delay in the close.
So,
they're preparing for the
So sometimes when we do these things as a lender, we kind of like, we need to like bring our headgear in, because we get beat up by everybody for these situations, you know? So I can't speak for Bank of America. I started out my career there. There's a reason I don't work there anymore. But like, I would just reiterate the same thing. Just expect there's going to be issues. Like Tom said, there, you know, hey guys, I wish it was like cell phones that we were dealing with, because whether I get an iPhone or an Android, that's pretty sexy to talk about. I get to go look at those cool phones, and that's fun. But man, we talk about real estate. We talk about selling a house with, they went to their bank because it's the huge name and the U-Haul's loaded up. I mean, I know there's a lot of stress. I mean, we carry that, you know? I mean, it is. That's why I think, again, it just goes back to, you have simultaneous closings. Man, those are the most stressful situation, right? They really are. And it's just, we've taken it for granted that it's just, it goes and it's good, it's easy. So just, I think you just anticipate stuff like that. But to answer your question directly, no, I've never heard of that. I don't know why that would be the case. I have no idea. I know that Bank of America is on every street corner. They can be very, very picky. They don't necessarily need to worry about their reputation with individual agents, because they're going to get thousands of more mortgage applications the next day. So. The day of closing? Okay.
Well, when the home inspection got done, I had the engineer's report done. Well, then he flagged something, so then we had to have another company come out and do what he flagged, and then have him go back out and check it and give us the approval to go through. And we closed one at 11 and we closed one at 3:30 in the afternoon. 3:30 in the afternoon didn't get their package to the title company until 4:00 in the afternoon. So he had his stuff, like you say, on a truck in those people's driveway.
Yeah.
You know, so thank God that we did close, but I just kept calling. I just kept on them every single day, those engineers and stuff, to get it done. But I mean, if that came up now, and then we found out she owned the land, the acreage, but she didn't own the mobile home because Green Tree never transferred it into her name. So then the title company just found out 2 days before closing. I said, hey, wait a minute.
They got a title issue. They got a title issue. Finally, beat on the title guy. Beat on the title guy.
Doing.
What's up with those title companies?
They're the worst.
So,
you know, she got it done because I was like, you gotta be kidding me.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think that if this happens when this is in effect, we're gonna be in trouble.
But I wouldn't expect that's gonna happen all the time. I think if you took just one word and really, really focus on the one word for the next 60 days, just proactive. Just be proactive. Like, we've had a proactive loan closing process since fourth quarter. And our benchmark is get a clear to close list 3 days prior to closing, get a package out at least 2 days prior to closing, get a HUD statement in their hands, reviewed, approved, all that good stuff at least 1 day prior to closing. And then we get a HUD out or a package out 2.5 weeks prior to close. It's pretty awesome. You know, this stuff doesn't happen. Because then your issues with Bank of America don't happen when you got a HUD statement in hand and the loan's clear to close. So, yes.
Trusting you with a huge life change for them, you know, buying or selling a home. So you're the expert. You get the chance to do it. And you know all this, it's just in a different form. So kind of keep that in mind.
Awesome. Yes?
Closing disclosures, they're supposed to get to the buyer by 3 days prior to closing. What do they get, like the prenup that they usually get in the beginning of the process? Do they get something like this?
Yeah, so it's called a loan estimate. So rather than the GFE, the loan estimate is, this whole thing is basically combining the truth in lending and like the GFE document. So it's like combining a couple of the documents into one. So kind of on that, it's a great thing. I mean, standard form, yep. It's basically a reformatted good faith estimate. Very similar to what you're looking at. It's I think it's way more user-friendly for the consumer. Yep.
Yeah, I think overall, as Tanya alluded to, this isn't bad. This isn't a bad thing. The only it's the 3 days that are going to be the initial problem, just delivery of that for the lenders. And then once they figure out how to do that more efficiently and how to get everything done in time, then it's going to be good. And those of you who are educated and really understand these forms and are able to go through them, you really should be at the point where if they call you on the phone and say, what is this on page 2? item G. I'm not sure if there's a G on page two, but you should know what that is. Maybe have this form with you. Maybe have a blank form so you can, it at least describes everything. And then one you know, kind of one closing thought for me is use us as a resource. Whether you're closing a deal with my company or not, and whether your lender is Brian or not, I know both of us are available to any of you with questions. Or four questions. Jim has, for the last 5 years, referred dozens of typically newer agents or agents dealing with a new scenario that is affected by title or that affects title to me. They call me out of the blue and they say, "Hi, I'm so-and-so. I've never spoken to this person." And we have a conversation about what their issue is. And I try to walk them through some possible solutions to that. And if it never becomes a client, that's okay. I'm still helping someone, helping a future home agent. And that's why I'm here. I'll tell you a really common one is the Friday afternoon phone call from the really upset agent representing the buyer, trying to buy a bank-owned property. And today's the closing date, and they said they're just not going to close. And what do I do? I said, well, I'd be happy to give you the number for an attorney who's really good. And by the time he calls you back on late Monday, they're already going to have your closing scheduled for Tuesday. So your buyers are SOL, and the U-Haul truck's going to sit in the driveway, and there's really not much you can do. So getting back to being proactive, a really important piece of advice that I don't think people hear. If you're buying a bank-owned property, if your buyer is, look at the calendar by the weeks, not just by the months, and don't schedule it for Friday. Schedule it for Tuesday so you can get it closed on Thursday. That way they don't have to ruin a whole weekend. So no Friday closings for REO purchases. Just a tip. And you know, there are probably some really good REO title companies out there, but I haven't heard of them yet. The issue is with as you all know, with the companies handling a lot of bank-owned properties, and I've specifically stayed away from hooking up with any asset management companies or REO divisions for banks. I've missed out on a ton of money by doing that, but they become, in order to be that company, you typically have to be cheap because you go into a contract with that property management company, that asset management group, and in order to be cheap, you have to pay your people not very much, so you get a less talented pool of employees, and you have captive business. You have guaranteed business. So if you, as the buyer's agent, hate me and you never want to work with me again, that's okay. I've got SunTrust's special asset division. They call it SAD. I've got them sending me 400 deals a month, so you can just be on your way. And when you have another buyer that wants a bank-owned property, you're forced to work with me. So they don't see you or your client as their client. It's a necessary evil. So when it's Friday afternoon, the lady making $9 an hour to process your deal doesn't have the package from the lender, she's going home. She'll see you Monday or Tuesday. What are you going to do about it? So specifically with REO, no Fridays. And they'll appreciate that because they don't want to work on Fridays. Doing it for them.
Where do you break?
Okay.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thanks, everyone, for coming out. That's all I got for today. So appreciate it. Be on your way. Enjoy your weeks. Hopefully you all had a great holiday weekend, and now you can get back to work and make yourself some money. All right. Oh, there you go. Box of pens in the back. All right. Have a good day, everyone. Thanks. Yeah.